Hi there, and welcome to the very first class of the Archimedes Academy by IAM Systems. I am Matthew Corvers, one of the founders of the company and currently the head of production. In the upcoming videos, we're going to tell you about how the drive industry works, what kind of technologies there are, and also how the Archimedes drive works. With that, we can compare the performance and see what's so special about the Archimedes drive and see how it can fit your application. It's at a level that is for non-technical people, so everybody should be able to follow. But if you know more about the topic and already know about your planetary drives, your harmonic drives, your cycloidals, you can skip to lecture 5 because that is where it gets really interesting. And if you're not, well, then follow me to the first class about what a mechanical drive is. And we're going to discuss first explaining what a drive does. Because I'm going to assume you're a complete noob. So let's start with, we have a motor, and this motor spins very fast at 100 meters per second. But it has a very low torque, and torque is the rotational force. A torque of 1 Newton meter, which is not uncommon for an electrical motor. But on the other hand, we have a big robot that needs to carry heavy loads. And to move the joint with those loads, it needs a torque of 100 Newton meter. And that's possible, because if you put a drive in between, you have a device with a certain ratio that transforms that torque. So this 1 Newton meter motor can now drive this 100 Newton meter of torque. But it does come at a cost, and that's speed. So if the input speed is 100 rotations per second, the output speed will now be 1 rotation per second. So that's what a drive does. And if I say that's what a drive does, I could also say that's what a speed reducer does, because drive, speed reducer, and gearbox are the same terms for the same device. Although you will hear me say gearbox way less often, because the Archimedes drive simply doesn't have gears, we move via another way. And now we're going to some terms that are a bit more difficult. That's the actuator and the transmission system. Because it differs per region on this world, but also per industry, what the exact definition is. For example, the automotive industry explains it a little bit different than the robotics industry. But in the robotics industry of Europe and North America, we typically talk about an actuator as the components that get the motion going. So that's the motor and the drive typically, and sometimes the encoder is there to determine the position as well. And in some cases where we have direct drive applications, if not a lot of torque is needed, we just skip the drive and make movement with the motor, and then the actuator is simply the motor. Then we have a transmission system, and that's pretty much everything that gets the motion going after the motor. So the drive is included in there. But every moving component, all the way to the end effector, the thing that does something at the end of a robot, is considered a transmission system. So also, like in this robot, where after the drive there comes a belt, this belt is part of the transmission system. Then I would like to talk about the types of drives we have, because there are 3 very common ones in the robotics industry, and so a lot of other ones, but they are so niche that I'm not going to discuss them right now. First, there's the cycloidal drive consisting of 2 discs that rotate around each other. And we're going to discuss it in more detail in the next class. In class 3, we will talk about the strain wave gear. And it consists of a flexible cup, a flex spline, and it moves throughout the system. Some of you will also know it as the harmonic drive, because that's the company who invented it and had a patent for it that lasted decades. In the end, I will also discuss the planetary drive. Why it's called like that is no surprise, I guess, because it pretty much looks like planets evolving around the sun. And with that, I also want to discuss the scope of our lectures a bit more, because Well, you can have drives for and gearboxes for combustion engines, but also for electrical motors. And these are completely different. Combustion engines are the ones that are fueled by gasoline that's burned and gets movement going. And for electrical motor, the power comes from either the grid or a battery. But for combustion engines, there's always, in terms of speed, a very small range, where they are very effective and provide a very high torque. But if you want to move faster, at a certain moment, it doesn't deliver that torque anymore. And that's why in a car, you shift gears and then go to the second gear, because here there's a torque peak again at a higher speed. And you can do that again and again until you have the torque that fits your vehicle velocity. For electrical motors, this is a non-issue, because we are always at that peak. And therefore, electrical motors always have one drive with one fixed ratio that's completely tuned to the motor. And finally, I want to talk about drive properties. Every drive has a lot of properties, of course, that are important to someone who buys them. And there can be a lot that influence. So I group them in these categories, and in other, you can also find efficiency and reduction ratio, amongst others. In the final lecture, we're going to cover all of them and see how all drives perform. But some I will already explain in earlier classes, just to give you an idea of what they mean. I hope you got a bit of an idea of the scope of the lectures, of what a drive is, and I hope you liked it and want to follow more classes. The next one will be about cycloidal drives. And if you have any questions or comments, don't forget to leave them below the video and we will try to answer them for you. Have a nice day.